Okay. Thank you everybody for joining us on this Monday. Today we have our special guest, Dr. Bill Buxton. He is board certified in neurology with a subspecialty certification in clinical neurophysiology. And he's the director of Neuromuscular and Neurodiagnostic Medicine and of Fall Prevention at our Pacific Neuroscience Institute. He started at UCLA with a bachelor's in biochemistry and continued on to do medical school at UCLA along with internship and residency at UCLA. He stepped out very slightly away from UCLA during his fellowship in clinical neurophysiology, where he was at UCLA and Cedars. So he's been here at Pacific Neuroscience Institute since 2018, helping to create our brain health program, which our Movement Disorders Center works very closely with. He has interests in neuropathies, autoimmune disorders, of particular relevance, the interface between neurology, rheumatology, and orthopedics. And so we're really excited to hear from him today, discuss fall prevention, as well as the neuromuscular overlap with our patients with Parkinson's disease. Thank you, Dr. Buxton, for joining.
Definitely. Thank you, Dr. Petrosian, for your introduction. And as Dr. Petrosian mentioned, a big part of my practice is nerve and muscle disorders. So sort of below the neck neurology, along with assessing and treating spinal problems, and have developed a real interest in the last 5 to 10 years in preventing falls. And we'll start with a little exercise here. I've got a gentleman who is fallen at the bottom of some stairs, and just look at some common household things that we may not give much thought, but do increase our fall risk. He's walking downstairs into what looks like probably a poorly lit basement. He's got a glass there, so he's probably trying to walk downstairs and carry something at the same time, which takes away our ability to give full attention to walking down the stairs and to holding on with both hands. If he was drinking alcohol, and both the short run can increase fall risk, and in the long run can worsen neurologic problems that can increase fall risk. So if that is alcohol, that could have contributed to his fall. He's got glasses sitting there. We'll presume that those are bifocals, which can be very helpful in terms of helping us see things at a distance and up close. But do tend to throw off our balance, especially after we get those. So a regular eye exam and good training, if bifocals are needed, is important for our fall prevention. He's got a hard tile floor at the bottom of the stairs, which does not increase risk of falls, but does increase risk of injury. But when walking on slippery floors, does increase risk of falls also. And then it looks like he's wearing some slippers that don't have support in the back, that don't have good support. Looks like one and maybe both of those fell off as he was walking down the stairs. So just our footwear is important also. So just some things to look at in your home environment that may increase the risk of falls, whatever the medical problem is that increased your risk of falls. So we'll talk about falls. Falls, unfortunately, are super common. A third of people over 65 fall each year, and a half of those falls are recurrent falls. And a tenth of those falls result in serious injury. And up to two-thirds of those falls are moderate to severe in severity, to the point that they limit our ability to do activities of daily living, such as cooking and bathing, dressing, walking. So falls can have a pretty striking bad impact and even increase our risk of death. quarter of people over 65 who break their hips die within years. So, so we definitely want to try to keep everybody on their feet and reduce falls because they can have very bad effects, which we want to avoid. And the single best predictor of future falls is prior falls. So especially two or more falls in the prior year or any fall with injury. So even though falls may seem minor in the moment, they can seem minor. They oftentimes are not, but even what seems like a minor fall is something that warrants further medical workup and attention. So if you do fall, check with your doctors about that. And now we'll talk about places along the nervous system that affect our balance. I'll talk briefly about the brain and brainstem, which is much more Dr. Petrosian's area. But we'll start off by talking about the brain, the basal ganglia, and the brainstem. With the cerebrum, or the biggest part of the brain, the thinking and processing part of the brain, the basal ganglia, which is deep inside the brain, and the brainstem, which is sort of a relay station between the brain and the spinal cord, and the cerebellum, which is mainly mainly takes care of balance problems and coordination of the arms and legs. Much more important than just that, but as a rough rule of thumb, it's our coordination control center. And again, the cerebrum, the uppermost part of the brain, is the main processing and decision-making center. So it's where we process input coming from the world around us and make decisions about how to react to the world around us and initiate any activities that we want to do. The basal ganglia, that deep part of the brain, fine-tunes our movements. It's the area that's most affected in Parkinson's and other movement disorders. The brainstem is that relay area between the brain and the spinal cord. And it also controls muscles and lets us receive input from our face and our throat, our eyes and ears, and also includes the inner ears. So a lot of times balance problems are caused by inner ear problems or vestibulopathies, and that's part of the brainstem. And again, the cerebellum is that mid-sized structure behind the brainstem, which is probably the most important part in coordination, but works in tandem with most other parts of the brain on coordination. And then moving down below the neck, below the brain to the spinal cord, we all know about our vertebrae, which are the bones in our spine. And it's divided into segments. The vertebrae give us a normal amount of motion. They let us move our neck and back, but not too much. And they also support our spinal cord and spinal nerves that I'll talk more about in a minute. And it's divided into regions. There's the cervical region or the neck. We've got 7 vertebrae there. The thoracic region or the upper back, we've got 12 vertebrae there. The lumbar region or the lower back, we've got 5 there. The sacrum and coccyx, the sacrum is the larger part of the tailbone. The coccyx is the very bottom of the tailbone. And we've got 5 vertebrae that most people are more connected in the sacrum, and we have nerves coming out between each of those vertebrae, coming to our arms, our torso, and our legs. And then looking from below, like a slice of bread pulling out one level of the spinal cord, you see we're created with a lot of bones. So this sort of brownish area is bones that protect our nerve structures in our spine. The spinal cord is sort of that main wire, that main bundle of nerves. The white matter is the insulated wiring part of the spinal cord. And gray matter is neurons that receive input, incorporate input from different nerves, and then pass it on either up to the brain or out from the brain down to the arms and legs. We've got our spinal nerves. There's one nerve on each side between each vertebra that go out to the arms and legs. And pardon me, both receive input from the arms and legs or sensory nerves that come in more from the back or the posterior root. And the anterior root sends signals from our spinal cord out to our arms and legs and controls the activity of those limbs. And we've got what are called dermatomes, which are the areas of our scalp, our arms, our torso, and our legs that correspond with each of those spinal levels. In the arms and legs, they're like more linear, more lines that come out. In the trunk, they're more like bands. And so they're labeled C for cervical, T for thoracic, and L for lumbar. And those are, those each are coming from and destined to go to one of those spine levels between vertebra. And then they break up as they get out into the arms and legs and individual nerves, as shown here, looking from the back. The plexus, the brachial plexus, the lumbar and sacral plexus are the bundle of nerves that incorporate input and output going from the spine to the arms and legs. And then the nerves branch off into nerves like axillary nerve that lets us feel and control our shoulders, the median nerve, which is the main nerve to our hand, and the ulnar nerve, which is the pinky, the funny bone nerve that wraps around the back of the elbow. And we'll talk more about how each of these individual peripheral nerves individually and globally can play into neurologic problems that can affect balance. So we'll start by talking about peripheral polyneuropathy. It's probably the most common nerve and muscle disorder that comes to neurologists' attention. And it's when nerves overall aren't working 100%. Because it affects the longest nerves the first, it tends to start in the feet and then later in the hands, and the symptoms then ascend up the limbs. And most common symptoms are burning or numbness. So people will feel like there's something hot in their socks or feel like they can't feel things as well with the toes. Sometimes people feel like they're walking on sand. They feel like they've got their socks crumpled up when they're not. Usually starts and for a long time just remains sensory symptoms, so numbness or burning, but then can sometimes cause weakness. There are rarer types of neuropathies that cause weakness first, but then most neuropathies, people will have the sensory symptoms for a while and then start to notice weakness, initially in the toes, so trouble controlling toes, holding on to things with toes, and then over time the ankles can start to bend and toes can catch on things. Until recently, the most common cause worldwide of peripheral neuropathy was leprosy or Hansen's disease. In the last 20 to 25 years, that has been surpassed by what in the Western world was the most common cause, and that's both diabetes and prediabetes. So even people whose A1C, which is that test of average blood sugar over the last 6 weeks, if that falls in the borderline high range, that's enough to cause neuropathy. And the sooner sugars get under control, the more likely the neuropathy is to reverse. So if somebody does have an A1C of say 5.9 or 6, it's really time to start pulling back on sweets and simple carbs, sugary beverages, and really increase exercise to get that back down, because once diabetes is fully established, it's much harder to reverse neuropathy, which oftentimes can't be reversed at that point. Sometimes could be managed, but the neuropathy can't be reversed. And then the second most common cause is alcohol. Anything more than about a drink a day, one alcohol equivalent, so a glass of wine, a can of beer, or a shot of whiskey, is enough to cause neuropathy. Any alcohol contributes, but the risk really goes up with that alcohol equivalent per day. So if you can avoid alcohol entirely, neurologists encourage you to do that. I know there's a school of thought that red wine can help with heart disease. So why stay away from alcohol, especially red wine? There are other things that are good for the heart, like exercise and keeping vascular risk factors under control, taking oral resveratrol, which is the active substance in red wine, probably has cardiac benefit, but alcohol in the short run will make you wobbly on your feet, and in the long run can damage your nerves and throw off your balance. So there's considerable more risk of damage from alcohol than any potential benefit. When working up neuropathies, neurologists check lots of other blood tests. The other common causes are vitamin B12 deficiency, thyroid dysfunction, and medications, especially chemotherapies, which usually cause neuropathy right after someone gets the chemotherapy, but in not infrequent settings can come a year or two after they get the chemotherapy. And associated symptoms that may point towards something other than an adistal polyneuropathy. Radiculopathy or pinched nerves in the spine. The bones around the spine and the discs, which are like shock absorbers between the vertebrae, over time, starting in our 30s and 40s, start to form little bone spurs. The discs pooch out a little bit and push on the nerves coming out of the spine, out to the arms and legs, and can cause pain in the neck and back. And that pain comes out as shooting pain down along one of those dermatomes, one of those lines that come from a specific nerve. It's what's commonly called sciatica in the legs. So if somebody has neuropathy symptoms, they've got burning or pain or numbness, but it's not just in the toes, but it's more in along more of a band or line in the arms and or legs, makes us think more that the problem's in the back than in the nerves themselves. And individual nerves, going back to that diagram of the individual nerves in the arms and legs, can misfire, usually from compression. The most common causes, most common example is carpal tunnel syndrome, which is a pinched median nerve right here at the wrist. Causes numbness mostly in the hand and the thumb through the middle finger more than the pinky and ring finger. And that numbness oftentimes comes out of sleep or with driving, the positions when our wrists are a little bit more bent and put pressure on the nerve. There's cubital tunnel syndrome, which is also fairly common. And it's a pinched nerve here at the back of the elbow and mostly affects the pinky and the ring finger. And usually just avoidance of pressure on the elbows takes care of that. And when that happens, you want to make sure your elbow doesn't get too bent or too straight, especially at night. Try to keep it in between. Both of those respond well to occupational therapy. Braces can help carpal tunnel syndrome. And then the legs, the most common focal neuropathy we see is a perineal or fibular neuropathy at the fibular neck, which is a pinched nerve at the knee on the outside of the knee and top of the shin, usually from crossing legs. And that tends to cause numbness in the foot along with a foot drop or where ankle weakness, where the toes tend to catch on things and people have trouble bending at the ankle and lifting their foot up. I'll talk briefly about muscles. Muscle disorders are called myopathies. They're much less common than nerve problems. Tend to cause muscle pain and weakness, but because nerves are not affected, there's usually not numbness associated with it. They tend to affect larger muscles close to the body, so especially shoulder muscles and hip muscles. Oftentimes people will first notice that walking upstairs is hard and brushing your hair is difficult. So things that use those hips and shoulders. Neuromyopathies are not really common. There are autoimmune disorders that cause inflammation in muscles where the immune system gets overactive. A handful of medications do. Statins on rare occasions, usually just in people with genetic predisposition to problems with statins, can cause myopathies, but most people on statins who have muscle pain, we find that the muscle pain is not from the statin, but rather from other things. Statins are common. Other things that can cause muscle pain are common. So if you do have muscle pain and are on a statin, check with your doctor for a good workup before you stop the statin, since we want to keep everyone's vascular health strong also. And then finally, we'll talk about neuromuscular junction disorders. They're disorders where there's a problem with communication between nerves and muscles. Myasthenia is the most common. And this is something we think about when somebody has balance troubles or weakness in their limbs. Again, does not tend to affect sensations, so people don't have numbness. They've got weakness. It's usually worse later in the day as the reserve that we have between nerves and muscles starts to break down over time. And they tend to affect muscles we use continuously the most, so muscles that are firing all day. So especially our eyelids, our swallowing muscles, and our eye muscles. So early symptoms are often double vision, droopy eyelids, or trouble swallowing. And also our quadriceps and muscles in the fronts of our thighs and our calves that help keep our knees and ankles stabilized as we're on our feet. So that is a quick overview of nerves and muscles in the spine, arms, and legs, and how problems with those can affect balance. And does anyone have any questions I can answer?
Thanks, Phil. One of the questions I get asked a lot, by the way, folks, those of you in the audience, as you're aware, please use the Q&A to send us questions and we'll ask them as they arrive. While people are typing, I'll ask a question that a lot of my patients will ask, which is when they're having gait issues, especially when they're having postural issues, how do we distinguish between spine or back, low back problems versus Parkinson's related posture problems?
They're both very common. A lot of people with spine problems have Parkinson's, and a lot of people with Parkinson's have spine problems. So just a really good thorough neurologic exam can help sort that out a lot. We can do specialized nerve and muscle tests called nerve conduction studies and EMGs that show and help pinpoint irritability of nerves in the back versus in the arms and legs. Those tests are usually normal in Parkinson's. So if they're abnormal, it can point towards the back as a relatively large contributor to the posture problems. MRIs of the lumbar spine can be helpful, but most people over about 65 have some degree of wear and tear in their back that oftentimes is not significant. So we don't want to make decisions based just on MRIs, but they can be very helpful in verifying degenerative changes in the spine. And just history can be really helpful. If people get back pain when they're on their feet, if people have, again, some of those associated symptoms like back pain can get into the legs, numbness and tingling, and weakness in the legs that's worse on one side than the other, things that Parkinson's does not tend to cause that back problems do cause.
Thank you. There's a question. I'm not sure that it's quite relevant to a neuromuscular conversation, but I suppose it's more of a balance question about dizziness with carbidopa-levodopa and, you know, how that relates to balance issues. I don't know if you wanted to answer that, Bill.
I'll defer to you as to whether there's anything else to add, but with levodopa carbidopa, one of the most common problems we see is orthostatic hypotension, where people's blood pressure drop when they sit up or stand up, which is unfortunately a not uncommon side effect of levodopa carbidopa or Sinemet. So those are individuals just need to be super careful getting up slowly, staying well hydrated, especially on hot days. We used to tell people to wear compression hose, which are uncomfortable and probably don't do a whole lot. Wearing an abdominal binder or girdle can actually help, just because a lot of the blood we're finding pulls in the abdomen rather than in the legs. When that happens, the reason that happens is we lose our ability to increase our blood pressure when we stand up, because a fair amount of blood goes down into our abdomen and into our legs. We're actually finding drinking about 15 ounces of water, 1.5 ounces of water, 15 to 30 minutes before getting out of bed in the morning or before somebody's going to be on their feet for a while. It's oftentimes just enough for people to keep from getting a clinically significant or symptomatic drop in their blood pressures. So just starting off your day with a bottle of water or a glass of water at your nightstand, there when you go to bed the night before, drink that over the course of a few minutes, slowly sit up, spend 15 minutes reading in bed, sitting up, and then slowly try to stand up from that, oftentimes manages those symptoms.
That's a great point, Bill. And a lot of times people will tell me they're drinking enough water, but I think what you're trying to say is it's sort of like the timing of the water and sort of how quickly you drink it. And just for people to, you know, just in case people aren't aware, 15 ounces is essentially a pint glass. So if you don't, because a lot of times when people think about a glass of water, well, you know, I don't know how big the glass is that they're drinking from. So if you think about a pint of beer, just replace that with a pint of water. And I suspect that a cold water might be, you know, better in terms of sort of bringing that blood pressure in kind of more. Sure, cool. Yeah. But the concept of doing all of that before even getting up to sort of set your day right makes a lot of sense to me. I think a lot of people might drink that amount of water, but sort of gradually over the course of a few hours, you know, here and there. Thank you for bringing up orthostatic hypotension, because I think the other area of your expertise that our patients struggle quite a bit with is autonomic neuropathy and autonomic insufficiency. So most patients experience this, but not all of them are aware that those symptoms sort of tie into each other with this dysfunctioning of the autonomic nervous system, or one might call it automatic nervous system. So the concept of the constipation, the urinary symptoms, you know, we've had other extensive conversations about those. I don't, you know, I'd refer anybody who's interested to go back to our YouTube page to kind of hear more about that. But I don't know, Bill, if you wanted to mention anything about managing the neurovascular component of not just orthostatic hypotension, but also you know, the diaphoresis and the cold hands or the sweating and, you know, those kinds of struggles, because that tends to be a very difficult thing for patients.
It is. Oftentimes can be the most bothersome symptoms in a lot of ways, because we don't have options that are as good for managing those symptoms as we do the motor or movement problems of Parkinson's. It's a lot of trial and error. So it's the autonomic nervous system. So it's the things that happen without our having to think about it, that both Parkinson's and peripheral neuropathies can cause dysfunction in. So just being creative, working together with with your primary doctor, with the cardiologist, if you see one, paying close attention to diet for the constipation, and just trying to see what symptoms, what problems can be treated versus which can be treated symptomatically versus those that we can find a workaround to help with just with our daily routines.
There was another question about myasthenia and just defining what myasthenia is, and is it the same as myasthenia gravis?
Myopathies, which are problems with the muscles themselves, and myasthenia, which is where nerves and muscles don't communicate well, either a problem with the nerves not being able to send signals to muscles or muscles being able to receive adequate input from nerves. There's a lot of overlap. They both tend to affect muscles high up in the legs, so thighs and hips a lot. There are some myopathies that can affect muscles in the face. Oftentimes, just in terms of the symptoms that people experience are very similar, but just a bedside exam in the neurologist's office can help sort that out. Was that your question?
I think that works. Another question got asked about numbness, tingling or hotness in the feet, as well as swelling in the lower leg, and sort of wanting to understand how that might or might not be related to Parkinson's.
So it is not classically or typically associated with Parkinson's. And in most instances, people who get burning in their feet who have Parkinson's also have a separate problem, usually a peripheral polyneuropathy, causing the burning. Swelling is usually not a neurologic problem, but I find for whatever reason, lots of people who have peripheral neuropathy also have swelling. But swelling is always something to address with your primary doctor to make sure that it's not a medication effect or that there's not a heart or kidney or liver problem causing that swelling. If the swelling's significantly worse on one side than the other, that's potentially an emergency or a blood clot in the leg. So that's something to get checked out. In my experience, a good many people with Parkinson's, for whatever reason, do tend to get redness and swelling. I think that's possibly in part just from not being able to be as active and blood pooling in the legs. So it's something we see a lot, but is not usually the effect of a nerve or muscle disorder.
Another area that people ask a lot about is, okay, well, we know that a lot of people have neuropathy or back issues or pinched nerves here and there. What is the best treatment option then? You know, that's where a lot of the questions come up is, are there considerations that one needs to give because of Parkinson's that would guide you as a neuromuscular specialist in terms of they should or should not undergo any particular procedure, that kind of thing?
So there's fortunately not a whole lot that Parkinson's keeps us doing in terms of treating back or nerve or muscle disorders. A lot of the first line care that we like to give for back and leg and balance disorders is physical therapy, which also is extremely helpful for Parkinson's. So those are both things that most physical therapists are able to manage well. The real improvement happens When people do their, when you do your home exercises that physical therapy teaches you, going to physical therapy oftentimes involves a little massage or heat or ice along with exercises. So people feel better after going to physical therapy, but those effects just from those visits are usually not very sustained, but doing the exercises that they teach you over time will help the current symptoms get better. And as your core and back and legs get stronger, that'll help prevent problems in the future also. So physical therapy plus a home exercise program is far and away first line and most effective. In terms of back pain, just to avoid potential side effects, interactions with medications. I like to start with topical things. So lidocaine patches, which are now over the counter, and the Clofenac gel or Voltaren gel, which is now over the counter, can be very helpful and usually our first line. For pain that needs more, the two main classes of medications that we use are anti-seizure medications, so pregabalin or gabapentin or Lyrica or Neurontin, tend to help a lot with nerve pain. They don't tend to help as much with musculoskeletal pain. They have the benefit of not having any significant interactions with other medications, including Parkinson's medications, or antidepressants. And the two we use the most are duloxetine or Cymbalta and venlafaxine or Effexor, which are good antidepressants. They have a little bit more interactions with medications, but no significant interactions with Parkinson's meds. They're good at preventing musculoskeletal pain. So if somebody has really bad back pain and nerve pain, I'll oftentimes go with one of those two first. They do have a risk of worsening orthostatic hypotension though. So we usually go a little bit more slowly with those. And all four of those meds can cause dizziness or drowsiness, so which can in turn throw off balance. So it's sort of a balancing act, but all of those have been around long enough and we see enough individuals suffering from both Parkinson's and back and nerve problems that with close monitoring, we can usually get those started and help individuals get relief with manageable side effects.
Can you speak to the vitamins or other treatments that you recommend not for pain or symptom management, but with the intent to actually improve the nerve function in people with neuropathy?
Definitely. There are two antioxidant supplements that are over the counter. One is alpha lipoic acid, and the other is acetyl L-carnitine. Which have good data. They probably act on the inflammation component. Most neuropathies have a component of inflammation and probably do help treat the underlying neuropathy and not just the symptoms, which is what the prescription medications do. Usually pretty well tolerated. Alpha lipoic acid can irritate the stomach a little bit, so just take it with food, but can be very helpful. Some vitamin supplements can be helpful, especially B12 and folic acid, but are really only helpful if people are deficient in those. So when we see patients for the first time, we'll check lots of blood tests and check those, and if somebody has a need for more B12 or folic acid, that can be helpful. A lot of people ask about CBD and THC nowadays. We don't recommend oral THC or CBD just because it can be pretty sedating, can cause some mood changes, not necessarily always good mood changes. And there's not a lot of quality control in terms of something that may say they're just CBD, which is not at the brain level as much. We're finding some THC in those. And we really don't know enough yet about interactions with other medications. So I don't recommend taking oral marijuana products. Topically, they're looking really promising. There may be minimal amount that gets absorbed in the bloodstream, but especially for musculoskeletal pain, a lot of people are finding, especially topical CBD, really helpful, and we're not seeing much in the way of side effects from that. Vitamin D can be helpful if somebody has low levels. So if somebody has low vitamin D levels, vitamin D supplementation is sort of like the old BASF ads where we don't make the product, we make the product better. Vitamin D tends to help people with neurologic disorders do better without treating the underlying problem. And there's a lot of research going into why that happens, but vitamin D probably helps neurologic problems indirectly. And we know that if somebody does fall, their bones are healthier if their vitamin D levels are normal. And if somebody is at risk for falling, we do recommend checking a vitamin D level annually and working with your primary doctor on seeing if you're due for a DEXA or bone density scan to check for osteoporosis.
Yeah, that's a really great point. What level of vitamin D do you look at? Because there's sort of some people who try to push for higher than sort of like a high normal vitamin D level. Do you have an opinion on that?
Definitely like to see things in the normal range. A lot of labs, normal range start at 30. Again, they start at 20. So I like to see usually at least 30. There is some growing data that aiming for really high levels may be more protective. I'm not recommending that yet, but I'm keeping a close eye out on that literature to see if that's a recommendation that we should be following more.
And then do you see a lot of heavy metal neuropathy or neuropathies related to heavy metals?
I don't see a lot. I see a lot of people with sort of borderline high heavy metal levels, which are most often from seafood. So we usually like to have people stay away from seafood for a week or two before doing heavy metal testing. I usually like a 24-hour urine collection, which is more reliable than just a single spot measurement in blood. And doing it with what's called speciation, which looks at whether it's inorganic or organic, whereas organic is something that's just linked to meat intake, or something that inorganic, which is more suggestive of a toxic exposure. So something we used to check for a lot, don't check for as much as we used to, but unless there's something in the individual's history, if they've worked in a factory or worked with heavy metals a lot, don't tend to check much.
A couple of really good questions came in. Going back to the vitamin D question, what about high vitamin D levels, like 100? Is there a, can you speak to vitamin D toxicity, please?
I honestly don't know a whole lot about toxicity, but if somebody is above their lab's normal range, they can usually pull back on supplementation. Don't like to see people above normal range.
And then what about low testosterone? I think there's been some interest in thinking about the hormones in general and brain health. You know, testosterone and muscle bulk, bone density. Is there a relationship between low testosterone and neuropathy? And what your recommendations are for testosterone supplementation, if any?
So I don't know of an association with neuropathy. Muscle bulk can definitely be decreased if somebody has deficiencies of testosterone. Testosterone is a double-edged sword. It increases risk of prostate cancer, increases risk of vascular problems, can cause mood problems. So before embarking on taking testosterone, we'd do that with the guidance of a trusted endocrinologist or urologist who can really address what the need is and what the anticipated benefit from that would be and the risks of doing that.
Okay. Giselle, do you have any questions that come to you frequently from patients that you wanted to address?
Dr. Buxton, thank you so much for your wonderful talk. I think with regards to fall, what other practical tips can you give our patients to prevent like falls?
So the single most important thing, it's like real estate, three most important things are location, location, and location. Physical therapy and exercise programs they teach are the three most important things. So get out, do physical therapy. There are increasing numbers of physical therapy practices that make house calls that don't require the strict home care regulations that home health agencies have. So there are a good many of the ones locally are called Luna and Pete Health, P-E-P-E. But I've got a patient who lives out in Palm Springs and those two companies don't go to Palm Springs, but she was able to find in a matter of 5 minutes, two companies that could come give her regular physical therapy in her home. So we're starting quickly to get to the point that you can get good physical therapy without having to go to a gym, because I know there's still some good reason for concern about the pandemic and being in a busy physical therapy center. And then after meeting with physical therapy, continuing an exercise program after that. Exercise classes can be super helpful, both for the strengthening, the balance training, and the social interactions also, but we'd probably get a good formal personalized physical therapy assessment and then sort of incorporate that into exercise classes. And then going back to the first slide, just be super mindful of your environment all the time. There are a lot of cracks in sidewalks around Southern California. So when you're out walking, be super mindful of that. Be trying to keep your eyes a little bit ahead to see what trip hazards they are. And then at home, make sure you've got clear paths. Make sure your house is well lighted. One thing that's been good that's come from the pandemic is we did most of our visits for the first several months on Zoom. So I was able to see things in people's homes that may not think to ask about, but if they're in the process of doing spring cleaning and have boxes on the ground for a few days, that those are trip hazards. If you're up at night to urinate, especially for men, make sure the path to your bathroom's clear. Make sure you've got a nightlight. Again, orthostatic hypotension can make jumping up and going to the bathroom at night a fall risk, so get up slowly. And for men, it can take a little getting used to, but getting a handheld urinal, or for men and women, a bedside commode, so you don't have to get up at all or don't have to go as far when you're up at night to go to the bathroom. So just be mindful of your home and outside environment.
Thank you very much, Dr. Buxton. I don't think we have any more questions in the chat box, Dr. P.
No, I think that was really great. Our patients really appreciate having that opportunity to sort of have the evaluation and testing to try to separate out, you know, what's from Parkinson's and what's from their back, et cetera, because it's a very common question. All right.
Well, thank you both for inviting me to speak. I enjoyed getting to do this.
Thank you for joining. All right.
So take care, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us today. Thank you, Dr. Buxton, for your time and your expertise with regards to really helping us tease out to, like, which is Parkinson's. And, you know, obviously sometimes it is really multifactorial, and the two sometimes can be both the reason for our patient's falls and pain as well. So thank you so much for your time. I just wanted to remind everyone that next month we will have Dr. Diaz talking about, like, Parkinson's disease, but this is going to be part of our Spanish series. So it will be in Spanish. So just a reminder to everyone, if you know of anyone who is a Spanish speaker who would want to learn more about Parkinson's, definitely let them know, and you're all welcome to join us, but it will be in Spanish next month. So once again, thank you so much, Dr. Buxton. Thank you, Dr. Petrosian, and everyone for being here today. Take care.
Take care. Thank you, everyone. Thank you.